doubt in my own mind that we've been drawn here by madmen.
First lot to be arriving in Jim's load. Another lot not far behind.
Good evening, Fred.
Good evening, Mrs. Rogers.
Is that the boat?
Oh, yeah, it is.
Oh, dear, already? Have you remembered everything?
I think so. Let's see. Lemons, slipsos, cream, eggs, tomatoes, and butter. That's all, isn't it?
Yes, that's right. So much to do, and I don't know where to start. No maids until the morning. Are these guests arriving today?
Oh, calm down. Everything's ship-shaped now. Looks nice, doesn't it, Fred?
Looks neat enough for me. Kind of bare, but rich folks like places bare, it seems.
Rich folks is strange.
And he's a strange sort of gentleman that's built this place. Spent a wicked lot of money on it, he did. And gets tired of it and puts the whole thing up for sale.
It's me why we always wanted to buy it.
Oh.
Living on an island.
Come off it, Ethel. The guests will be here any minute.
Making that steep climb is just a drink, I suppose. Like some others I know.
Oh, Debbie, I'm Jim. I'll be getting along. There's two gentlemen arriving in my car, I understand.
I shall want at least 5 loaves and 8 pints of milk, remember?
Right.
And don't forget the oil for the engine, Fred. I'll have the lights burning down low if we don't fill it back up.
To us, how long railway? It's at the station right now. I'll bring it across our first thing tomorrow.
And give a hand with the luggage, will you?
Right.
Not a very classy lot. Miss Claythorne. She must be the secretary.
Not uphold by her secretaries. First the hospital nurses, giving themselves airs and graces and looking down at the servants.
Now, come off it. Then come back to that lovely up-to-date kitchen of yours.
Too many newfangled gadgets for my fancy.
So, this is it.
How perfectly lovely.
Miss Claythorne.
You're Rogers?
Yes.
Good evening, Rogers. Will you take up my luggage and Captain Lombard's?
Yes.
You've been here before.
No, but I've heard a lot about this place.
From Mr. and Mrs. Owen?
No, old Johnny Brewer. He was a pal of mine. Bought this island, built this house. It's a sad and poignant story.
A love story?
Yes, ma'am. The saddest of all. Old Johnny was a wealthy businessman. Fell in love with the famous Lily Logan. Bought her this island and built her this house.
Sounds most romantic.
Poor Johnny. He thought if he could somehow hold her here, without even a telephone as a means of communication, he could somehow keep her.
But of course, the fair Lily tired of her ivory tower and escaped.
Yes, ma'am. Johnny went back to Wall Street, made a few more millions, and this place was sold.
And here we are. Well, I better go find Mrs. Owen.
It would be fairly rude of you to leave me here all by myself.
Would it? Well, I wonder where she is.
She'll be along when she's ready. While we wait, do you mind if I have a drink? I'm very dry.
Of course you could.
It's certainly warm after that steep climb. What's yours?
Oh, not for me, thanks. Not on duty.
A good secretary is never off duty.
Really? This is exciting.
What is?
All this, the sea, the gulls, the beach, and this lovely house. I'm going to enjoy myself.
I think you are. I think we both are. Here's to you. You're very lovely.
Where is Mrs. Owen?
Mrs. Owen
just left caught in your belt, that's all.
You knew.
Detained, but...
I have a list of the guests expecting.
I have some coins,
thank
but
you.
Not all of them.
How awful.
Yes, I have coins.
I say, you will be sweet and help me, won't you?
I won't move from your side.
Thank you. I say... It does seem rather odd to have brought only us over in the first boat and everyone else in the second.
That, I'm afraid, was by design, not accident.
Design? What do you mean?
I simply suggested there was no need to wait for the others. That and 5 shillings, and the boat engine soon started up.
You shouldn't have done that.
Well, they're not a very exciting lot, are they?
I thought the young man was rather nice looking.
Callow. Definitely callow, and very, very young.
I suppose you think the man who slippies is more attractive?
Oh, I don't think my own. I know.
Wizard place you got here?
I'm Mrs. Owen's secretary. Mrs. Owen has been detained in London, I'm afraid, and won't be down until tomorrow. May I introduce to you Captain Lombard, Mr.,
Marston. Anthony Marston.
Would you like a drink, sir?
Thank you.
What's yours? What would you like? Glass of sherry? Whiskey? Gin?
Whiskey, I think.
Wonderful place you have here.
I'm Mrs. Owen's secretary. Mrs. Owen has been detained in London, I'm afraid, and won't be down until tomorrow.
How are you?
Would you like a drink, Mr.?
Davis. Davis is the name.
Mr. Davis, Mr. Marston.
Pleased to meet you, Mr. Marston. How are you? Thanks, Mr. Lombard. Don't mind if I do. Bit of a stiff climb up here, but what a view and what a height. Reminds me of South Africa, this place.
Does it? What part?
Oh, Natal, Durban, you know.
Me? No, I don't.
Oh, well, here's to temperance. So you don't know South Africa. That's a shame. See, that's my natal state.
Sounds like an interesting country.
Finest country in the world, sir. Everything a man could want. Gold, silver, diamonds, oranges. Talk about a land just flowing with beer and Skittles.
How do you do?
General Mackenzie, isn't it? I'm Mrs. Owen's secretary. Mrs. Owen has been detained in London, I'm afraid, and won't be down until tomorrow. May I introduce to you Captain Lombard, Mr. Marston, and
Davis.
Mr.
Davis is the name.
Whiskey and soda, sir.
Thank you. You in the service?
I was. I was in the King's African Rifles. A bit too tame in peacetime. I chucked it.
Did he?
Where is Miss Owen?
Miss Brent, isn't it? I'm Mrs. Owen's secretary. Mrs. Owen has been detained in London, I'm afraid, and won't be down until tomorrow.
Indeed. Extraordinary. Did she miss her train?
I expect she did. Won't you have something? May I introduce to you Captain Lombard, General Mackenzie, Mr. Marston, and Mr.
Davis. Davis is the name. May I take your case?
Would you like a drink? Dry martini? Glass of sherry?
I never touch alcohol.
You've never touched alcohol?
I suppose you know, young man, that you left us standing there on the wharf.
That was my fault, I'm afraid. You see, I wanted to...
It seems to me most extraordinary that Miss Owen wasn't here to receive her guests.
Perhaps she's just the type of person who can't help missing trains.
That's what I reckon she is.
Not at all. She's the least like that.
Perhaps it was her husband's fault.
She hasn't got a husband. I should like to go to my room.
Of course. I'll take you there.
There he is. She will show you your room.
I'm afraid our host and hostess haven't arrived yet. My name's Lombard.
I'm Wargrave. How do you do?
How do you do? Would you like a drink, sir?
Yes, please. Whiskey.
How are you? Davis. Davis is the name. Quite a wonderful place we have here. Quite unique.
As you say, quite unique.
Your drink, sir.
Hello, Hatcher Berkeley, hold up, yeah?
Who?
The Hatcher Berkeley? He rolled me in for the show? When's he coming?
I don't think anybody of the name of Berkeley is showing up.
Double crossing. Oh well, it's a pretty wizard island. Rather wizard girl, that secretary. She ought to liven things up a bit. I say, old man, say for dressing up for dinner this time?
Let's go and explore.
Wizard.
I say, things are certainly at sixes and sevens without the Owens showing up.
Tricky, what? I say wizard place for a holiday, what?
Sorry, I didn't realize you're one of the family.
Well, to tell you the truth, I've never been here before. You see, I live at the Benton Club, have for the past 10 years, and my seat is just about there. Can't get you to sit anywhere else, frankly.
Comes a bit of a habit.
Yes, it certainly does. Well, it's certainly not as good as the clubs, but it's a nice chair. To tell you the truth, I was a bit surprised when I got this invitation. Haven't done anything of the sort for well over 4 years. It was very nice of them, I thought.
Lady Constance Comington expected here, can you tell me?
Lady Constance Comington? I don't believe so, sir. Unless she's coming with Mr. and Mrs. Owen.
Oh.
Allow me.
Can I have your keys, sir? No, thank you. I'll unpack for myself.
Dinner is at 8 o'clock. Shall I show you to your rooms?
Yes, please.
Mine's Armstrong. Dr. Armstrong, I believe.
Yes.
Thought so. Never forget a face.
Oh, don't tell me I've forgotten one of my patients.
Oh, no, nothing like that. I once saw you in court giving expert evidence.
Oh, are you interested in the law?
Well, you see, I'm from South Africa. Natural legal processes in this country are just bound to interest a colonial like myself.
Oh, yes, of course.
Have it?
No, thank you. I never touch it.
Do you mind?
Not a bit. Ah, yes. I thought as I was going across the mainland what a haven of peace it was.
Too peaceful for some, I dare say.
Yes, so wonderfully restful. Wonderful for the nerve. I'm a nerve specialist, you know.
No, sorry for that. Did you come down by train?
No, I motored down. I dropped in by a patient on the way. A great improvement, wonderful response.
Best part of 200 miles, isn't it? How long did it take you?
Oh, I didn't hurry. I never hurry. It's bad for the nerves. Some mannerless young fellow near Amesbury nearly drove me into a ditch, shot past me at about 80 miles an hour. I'd like to have had his number.
Yes, and if only more people would just begin to take the number of these young roadhogs.
Yes, now you must excuse me. I must have a word with Mr. Owen.
Oh, but Mr. Owen isn't...
Yes, sir.
Thank you. I'll see you won't lose by it. Can you show me to my room?
Just this way.
Studying. glasses. You're always leaving the dirty work to me. Here I am with a four-course dinner on my hands and no one to help me. Can you give me a hand with the dishing up? Who was that you were talking to, by the way?
Davis, South African gentleman. No class if you ask me, and no money either.
I don't like him. I don't like any of them much. More like that lob he had down in the boarding house, I'd say.
Man keeps up that he's a millionaire or something. You should see his underwear, cheap as they make it.
As I said, it's not treating us right. There's guests arriving today, and maid's not coming till tomorrow.
Now, the pay's good.
So it ought to be. Catch me going to the service again unless the money's good.
Well, it is good, so what are you going on about?
I can tell you this, Rogers. I'm not staying any place where I'm put upon. Cooking's my business. I'm a good cook.
First rate, old girl.
But the kitchen's my place, and housework is none of my business. All these guests. I've got a good mind to put my hat and coat on and walk out now and go straight back to Plymouth.
You can't do that, old girl.
Who says I can't? Why not? Would you like to know?
Did you forget it, dear? We're on an island.
Yes, I suppose I did. And I don't know as I fancy being on an island.
Come to think of it, I don't much either. No slipping off to a pub or going to the pictures. Now, it's double wages on account for the difficulties. And there's plenty of beer in the house.
That's all you ever think about, beer.
Now, come back to the kitchen or go to the table. Spoiled.
Spoiled anyway, I expect. Wasted on them. Thank goodness I didn't make a souffle. Oh, dinner won't be a minute, miss. Just a question of dishing up.
Are you sure you're all right, Rogers? You can manage between the two of you?
Yes, miss. The missus just talks a lot, but she gets it done.
What a lovely evening.
Yes, indeed. The weather seems very settled.
How plainly one can hear the sea.
A pleasant sound.
Hardly a breath of wind, and deliciously warm. Not like England at all.
I should have thought that you might feel a little uncomfortable in that.
No.
It's tight, isn't it?
Oh, I don't think so.
You'll excuse me, my dear, but you're a young girl. You've got your living to earn.
Yes.
Well, a well-bred woman doesn't like her secretary to appear off flashy. It's as though, you know, you were trying to attract the attention of the opposite sex.
And would you say I do attract them?
That's besides the point. A girl who deliberately sets herself to get the attention of young men won't be likely to keep her job long.
Surely that depends on who she's working for.
Really, Miss Claythorne?
Aren't you being a little unkind?
Young people nowadays behave in the most disgusting fashion.
Disgusting?
Yes. Low-backed evening dresses, half-naked on beaches, all the so-called sunbathing. An excuse for immodest conduct, nothing more. Familiarity, Christian names, drinking cocktails. And look at the young men nowadays. Decadent. Look at that young Marston. What good is he? And that Captain Lombard.
What is the matter with Captain Lombard? I should say he's a man who led a very varied and interesting life.
The man's an adventurer. This young generation is no good at all.
You don't like youth. I see.
What do you mean?
I was just remarking that you don't like young people.
And is there any reason why I should pray?
No, but it seems to me that you must miss an awful lot.
You're very impertinent.
I'm sorry, but that's just what I think.
The world will never improve until we stamp out immodesty.
Quite pathological.
What did you say?
Nothing.
What about the old boy? All judges look like tortoises. They have that venomous way of darting their head in and out. And Mr. Wargrave is no exception. Oh, yes. He's probably sentenced more innocent people to their deaths in England than anyone else. Hello, you. Have you met Mr. Armstrong? Armstrong and I were just discussing how the old boy looks.
Yes, I heard you, and so did he, I think.
Oh, Sir Lawrence.
Miss French, isn't it?
May I have a word out here with you?
Remarkably fine night.
Absolutely wizard cop. A supercharged Bugatti sports car lot. You didn't see many of those out there.
Did you come from London?
Yes. 208 miles, and I did it in a bit under 4 hours. Touched down and going over Salisbury Plain. Not too bad, eh?
I think you passed me on the road.
Oh, really?
You nearly drove me into a ditch!
Did I? Sorry.
If I had had your number, I would have reported you.
But you were footling along in the middle of the road.
Footling? Me, footling? Oh, well, what about a drink?
Good idea.
Miss Claythorne.
No, thank you.
Good evening, Mrs. Owen.
Why, Mrs. Owen?
Because you'd make for the most attractive wife of any wealthy businessman.
Do you always flirt so outrageously?
Always.
Well, now we know.
Say, what do you think Mrs. Brent and the Justice are talking about? I swear she tried to bun Holm earlier upstairs.
I don't know. Funny. She seemed so certain that there wasn't a Mr. Owen.
You don't think that there isn't? That they aren't?
What, married, you mean?
Yes.
Damn shame we don't know you. I could have given you a lift down.
Oh, that would have been grand.
I can show you what I can do across Salisbury Plain. Tell you what, maybe we could drive back together?
Oh, but I...
But it seems damn soon. I've got an empty car.
Yes, but she likes the way she's going back.
Look, all these sweet little soldier boys. And there's that old nursery rhyme.
What are you talking about? What soldier boys? What nursery rhyme?
10 little soldier boys going out to dine. One choked his little self, and then there were 9. 9 little soldier boys stayed up very late. One overslept himself, and then there were 8.
8 little soldier boys traveled. One got left behind, and then there were 7.
Ladies and gentlemen, silence please. You are charged with these indictments. That you did respectively, and at diverse times commit the following. Edward Armstrong, that you did cause the death of Louisa Mary Cleese. William Henry Bloor, that you brought about the death of James Stephen Landon. Emily Caroline Brent, that you were responsible for the death of Beatrice Taylor. Vera Elizabeth Claythorne, that you killed Peter Ogilvie Hamilton. Philip Lombard, that you were guilty of the deaths of 21 men, members of an East African tribe. John Gordon Mackenzie, that you sent your wife's lover, Arthur Richmond, to his death. Anthony James Marsden, that you were guilty of the murder of John and Lucy Combs. Thomas Rogers and Ethel Rogers, that you brought about the death of Jennifer Brady. Lawrence John Wargrave, that you were guilty of the murder of Edward C. Prisoners at the bar, have you anything to say in your defense?
Bring her to the couch. She's fainted, that's all. She'll be around in a minute. Get some brandy.
Roger, get some brandy.
Yes, sir.
What was that voice?
What's going on here? What kind of practical joke was that?
Where the devil did that voice come from?
Here it is.
You are charged with these indictments.
Turn it off! Turn it off, it's horrible.
What a disgraceful and heartless practical joke.
It's a joke, do you?
Oh, but what else could it be?
The present moment, I'm not prepared to give you an opinion.
Would the devil turn it on, though?
Is that annoying? We must inquire into that.
Oh, dear me. Oh, dear me.
Allow me, sir, if I talk to her.
Ethel, will you hear me? Pull yourself together. Get yourself together.
You'll be all right now, Miss Rogers. You just had a turn, that's all.
Did I faint, sir?
Yes.
It was that voice, that awful voice, like a judgment.
Where's the brandy?
Right here, Doctor.
Drink this, Miss Rogers.
I'm all right now. Just gave me a turn.
It gives hold her. Wicked wise, I'd like to know. Who was it that put that gun on? Was it you, Rogers?
I was just following orders, sir.
Whose orders?
Mr. Owens.
Let me get this quite clear. Mr. Owens' orders were what exactly?
I was to put on the grammar record for dinner. I thought it was just to give you all some music.
Very remarkable story.
It's the truth, sir. By heaven, it's the truth. I thought it was just a piece of music. It had a title on it.
Is there a title?
Yes, sir. The Swan Song.
This is preposterous. Absolutely preposterous. Slinging accusations about like this. This fellow, whoever he is.
That's just it. Who is he?
That is what we must go into very carefully. I suggest you get your wife to bed, Rogers, then come back here.
Yes, sir.
I'll give you a hand.
Will she be all right, Doctor?
Yes, quite all right.
Don't know about you, but I can use another drink.
I agree.
This is preposterous. Absolutely preposterous.
Let's keep you alive.
I should like a glass of water, please.
Yes, I'll get it. I could do with a little whiskey myself.
I've given her a sedative. She'll be quite all right now.
Now then, Doctor, you'll surely want a drink after all this. Oh, so you said. You'll have this one, General.
Now then, Rogers, you must get to the bottom of this. Tell us what you know about Mr. Owen.
He owns this place, sir.
I'm aware of that fact. I want you to know what you yourself know about him.
Nothing, sir. You see, I've never met him.
What do you mean you've never met him?
We were engaged here through a registry. The Regina in Plymouth. I received a letter.
That's a high-class firm. We can check on that.
Have you got the letter?
The letter and dating is together, sir.
Go on with your story.
We were to prepare the house for a party on the 4th. It was well stocked with food. It just needed dusting again.
What next?
Nothing, sir.
That is, we were to prepare the house for a party of 8.
Then yesterday by morning post, we received a letter saying that Mr. and Mrs. Owen might be detained, and if so, we did the best we could. It included instructions for dinner and a gramophone record.
Have you got that letter?
Yes, sir.
Headed Ritz Hotel and Titan.
Coronation machine number 5, quite new, no defects. Looks like ensign paper, the most common make. We shan't get much out of this. We might try it for fingerprints, but it's been handled too much.
Quite the little detective you are.
Not some fancy Christian names. You like Norman.
Quite a mouthful. You draw my attention to a curious and suggestive point, Mr. Marston. I think the time has come for all of us to pull all the information we have regarding our unknown host. We are all his guests. I think it would be probable if we could find out how that came about.
There's something very peculiar about all this. I received a letter with a signature that was very hard to read. It purported to be from a woman whom I've met at a certain summer resort 2 or 3 years ago. I took the name to be Ogden, but I am most certain that I've never met or become friendly with anyone by the name of Ogden or Owen.
Have you still got it?
Yes, I will fetch it for you.
Miss Claythorne?
I've never actually met Mrs. Owen. I wanted a holiday post and applied to a secretarial agency. Miss Grenfell's in London. I was offered this post and accepted.
And you were never interviewed by your prospective employer?
No. This is a letter.
I have received your name from Miss Grenfell's agency. I understand she knows you personally. I should be glad to pay you the salary you ask and shall expect you to take up your duties on August 8th. The train is the 12:10 from Paddington, and you'll be met at Oakbridge Station. I enclose £5 for expenses. Yours truly, Una Nancy O. Mr. Marston!
Don't actually know the Owens. I got a wire from an old pal of mine, Badger Berkeley. Surprised me a bit, because I thought the old fool went to Norway. I haven't kept the wire.
Thank you. Dr. Armstrong?
I think I may admit, in the circumstances, that My visit here was professional. Mr. Owen wrote me that he was worried about his wife's health, her nerves to be precise. He wanted a report about her being worried and therefore suggested that my visit here be regarded as that of a guest.
You had no previous acquaintance with the family?
No.
Yet you had no hesitation in obeying the summons.
A colleague of mine was mentioned in a very handsome fee was suggested. I was due for a holiday anyway.
Dear Miss Prentice, I do hope you remember me. We were together at Bellhaven Guest House in August some years ago, and we seemed to have so much in common. I am starting a guest house of my own on an island off the coast of Devon. I think there is really an opening for a place where there is good plain English cooking, and a nice, old-fashioned type of person. None of this nudity and gramophones half the night. I shall be very glad if you can see your way to spending your summer holiday on Soldier Island. As my guest, of course. I suggest August 8th, 1240 from Paddington to Oakbridge. Yours sincerely, you and... Yes, the signature is slightly ambiguous.
I like the nudity touch.
Here's my own decoy letter. Comes from a friend of mine, a lady Constance Colmington. Urges me to arrive here and speaks of her host and hostess in the vaguest of terms.
Look here. I've just thought of something.
In a minute.
But I...
We will take these one at a time if you don't mind, Captain Lombard. General Mackenzie?
I got a letter from this fellow Owen. I thought I must have met him sometime at the club. He had mentioned some old cronies of mine were to be here, and I thought I'd excuse myself some kind of informal invitation. Haven't kept the letter, I'm afraid.
Thank you. And you, Captain Lombard?
Same sort of thing. Letter mentioning mutual friends. I haven't kept it either.
Just now we had a somewhat disturbing experience. An apparently disembodied voice spoke to us all by name, uttering certain definite accusations against us. We will deal with those accusations presently. At the moment, I'm interested in a minor point. Amongst the names received was that of a William Henry Vore. Yet as far as we know, there's no one named Vore amongst us. The name of Davis was not mentioned. What have you to say about this, Davis?
Cat's out of the bag, it seems. I suppose I'd better admit now, my name isn't Davis.
You are William Henry Vore?
That's right.
I will add something to that. Not only are you here under a false name, but you claim to have come from natal South Africa. I knew South Africa very well, and I am prepared that you have never stepped foot there a day in your life.
First off, it's Natal. Second off, you gentlemen have got me wrong. I'm an XCID man.
Oh, a copper.
I've got my credentials and I can prove it. I run a detective agency out of Plymouth. I was put onto this job.
By whom?
Why, Mr. Owen sent a very nice money order along with expenses and said I was to join the house party posing as a guest. He also sent a list of all your names and said I was to keep an eye on you all.
Any reason given?
Said Mrs. Owen had some valuable jewels. Now, Mrs. Owen, my foot, I don't believe there is such a person.
The conclusions are, I think, justified. You look Norman, Owen. Uno Nancy Owen. That is to say, each time you and Owen, or by a slight stretch of fancy, unknown.
But... it's fantastic. Mad.
Yes, I have no doubt in my own mind that we've been drawn here by madmen. Probably a dangerous homicidal lunatic.
Oh my god.
Whoever it is who has enticed us here, that person has taken the trouble to learn a great deal about us. A very great deal. And out of that knowledge concerning us, has made certain definite accusations against us.
Soldier!
Person Putix! Wicked!
I wish to say this. Our unknown friend accuses me of the murder of one Edward Seaton. I remember Seaton perfectly well. He came before me for trial in June of 1930. He was charged with the murder of an elderly woman. He was very ably defended and made a good impression in the witness box. Nevertheless, on the evidence, he was certainly guilty. I summed up accordingly, and the jury brought in a verdict of guilty. The appeal was lost in the case of misdirection. The appeal was dismissed, and the man was duly executed. I wish to say that my conscience is perfectly clear on the matter. I did my duty and nothing more. I passed sentence on a rightly convicted murderer.
Did you know Seton at all? I mean, personally speaking.
I knew nothing of Seton previous to the trial.
The old boy's lying. I'll swear he's lying.
Now this fellow's a madman. Absolute madman. He's got a bee in his bonnet. He's got a hold of the wrong end of the stick all around. It's best to leave this sort of thing unanswered, really. However, I do feel obligated to say, no truth. There was no truth in what was mentioned about young Arthur Richmond. Richmond was one of my officers. I sent him on reconnaissance in 1917. He was killed. I'd also like to say, I resent this very much, slur on my wife, really. Been dead a long time. Absolutely. Best woman in the world, really. Caesar's wife.
I've just been thinking. Don and Lucy Holmes. Must have been a couple of kids I ran over near Cambridge. Beastly bad luck.
For them or for you?
Well, I was thinking for me. But of course you're right. It was bad luck for them too. Of course it was pure accident. They ran out of some cottage or other. I had my license suspended for a year. Beastly nuisance.
Oh, the speeding's all wrong, all wrong. Young men like you are a danger to the community.
It was just an accident. I couldn't help it.
Might I say a word, sir?
Go ahead, Rogers.
There was a mention, sir, of me and Mrs. Rogers and of a Miss Jennifer Brady. There isn't a word of truth in it, sir. We were with Miss Brady the night she died, sir. She was always in poor health the moment we came to her, sir. There was a storm the night she died. The telephone was out. We couldn't get a doctor to her. I went for him on foot, sir, but he was too late. There was never a word against us. Never a word.
Came into a nice little something at her death, I suppose.
Didn't you? Miss Brady left us a legacy in recognition of our faithful service. And why not, I might ask.
What about you, Blore?
What about me?
Your name was on the letter, wasn't it?
I know. Landor, you mean? That was London and commercial bankrupt.
I remember Landor, though it didn't come before me. You were the officer in charge of the case.
I wasn't.
Lander got penal servitude for life and died in Dartmoor a year later. He was a delicate man.
He was a crook. It was him who put the night watchman out. The case was clear from the start.
You were complimented, I think, on your able handling of the case?
Well, I got my promotion. I was only doing my duty, sir.
Convenient word, duty. What about you, Doctor?
I'm at a loss to understand the whole matter. What was the name? Close. I don't remember having a patient to that name, or it being connected in a death in any way. It was a long time ago, though. It may have been one of my old operation cases in the hospital. They come too late, so many of these people, and when the patient dies, it's always the surgeon's fault.
So some, of course, take up nerve cases and give up surgery. Others give up drink.
I protest! You have no right to insinuate such a thing! No right!
I never suggested. Besides, Mr. Owen is the only one who knows everything about us, anyways. Miss Claythorne?
I was a nursery governess to Peter Hamilton. We were in Cornwall for the summer. There was always a rock far out that Peter was wanting to swim out to. Of course I never let him, it was too dangerous. One day, when my attention was distracted, Peter started swimming out. And I rushed after him as soon as I saw, but the current had got to him, it was too late.
Was there an inquiry?
Yes. I was exonerated by a coroner, and his mother didn't blame me either.
Miss Brent?
I have nothing to say.
Nothing?
Nothing.
You wish to reserve your defense.
There was no question of defense. I have always acted accordingly to the dictates of my conscience.
Well, what a law-abiding lot we all seem to be. Myself excepted.
We are waiting on your story, Captain Lombard.
I haven't got a story.
What do you mean?
I'm sorry to disappoint you all, but it's true. I left my men, took my chance for the bush. Matter of self-preservation.
You abandoned your men?
Not quite the act of a proper gentleman, I know. But self-preservation is a man's first duty.
Our inquiry rests there. Now, Rogers, who else is on this island besides ourselves, you and your wife?
Nobody, sir. Nobody at all.
Are you sure of that?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Rogers, don't go. I'm not yet sure as to the reason of our unknown host in assembling us here. But as far as I know, he's not sane in the right sense of the word. He may even be dangerous. I should suggest that we get out of here as soon as possible. Perhaps tonight.
There's no boat on the island, sir.
No boat at all?
No, sir.
Why don't you telephone to the mainland?
There's no telephone, sir. Every morning, Fred Narracott comes with the bread and the milk and the eggs and the post and the papers, and he takes the orders.
Better ferret out of this before the whole thing blows up. Whole thing's like a detective story, positively thrilling.
At my time of life, I've no desire for thrills, Mr. Marston.
The legal life's narrowing. I'm all for crime. Let's do it.
He's dead!
Dead? Do you mean he just choked himself and died?
Call it a choking fit if you like. He died of asphyxiation right enough.
Never knew a man could just die of a choking fit.
In the middle of life, we are in death.
Call it a choking fit if you like, General Mackenzie. Marston's death is not what we would call a natural one.
Is there something in the whiskey?
Yes. Cyanide. Probably potassium cyanide. It acts pretty well instantaneously.
Then he must have put the stuff in there himself.
Suicide, eh? That's a rum go.
You'd never think he'd commit suicide. Why, he was so alive. He was enjoying himself.
Oh, look. A little soldier boy. Broken.
Oh, I know. Still, that fellow bringing the bread and all that. I should have thought he'd been here by now. No sign of breakfast. Where is Rogers?
Oh, don't let's bother about breakfast.
How's the weather looking?
The wind has freshened a bit. Pretty mackerel sky. Old boy in the train yesterday said we were due for some dirty weather. I shouldn't wonder whether he wasn't right.
Now, I wonder if that boat's coming. It's absurd not giving a boat on the island. The sooner we get out of here, the better.
No proper harbor. If the wind were to come to blow from the southeast, a boat would get dashed to pieces against the rocks.
The boat would always be able to make us from the mainland.
No, Miss Brent. That's exactly what it wouldn't.
So you're saying we should be cut off from the land?
Yes. Condensed smoke, gravita, and tin self till the gale has blown itself out. But you needn't worry. The sea's only a bit choppy.
The pleasures of living on an island are rather overrated.
I wish that boat would come. Annoying how the house is built slap up against the cliff. You can't even see the mainland until you've climbed up to the top. Shall we go up there again?
It's no good, Doctor. A watch pot never boils. There was no sign of a boat putting out, and we were up there just now.
What can this man Narracott be doing?
They're all like that in town. Never hurry themselves. And where's Rogers? He ought to be about. If you ask me, Master Rogers was pretty badly routed last night.
I know. Ghastly, the whole thing.
Got the wind up properly. I take an even bet that he and his wife did the old lady in.
You really think so?
Well, I never saw men more scared. Guilty as hell, I should say.
Oh, fantastic. The whole thing, fantastic.
I say, suppose he's hopped in.
Who? Rogers? But there's no way he could have. You've just said so. There's no boat on the island.
Yes, but I've been thinking. We only have Rogers's word for that. What if there is one and he's nipped off in it the first thing?
Oh, no. He wouldn't be allowed to leave the island.
Sleep well, General.
I dreamed. Yes, I dreamed.
I have no doubt about that.
I dreamed of my wife. Leslie, you see.
Oh. Yes. I wish Narakot would come.
Who is Narakot?
Huh. He's the bloke who drove us over yesterday afternoon.
Was it only yesterday?
Yes, I feel that way myself sometimes. Patty Grimphone records, suicides, it's all about a man can stand. I shan't be sorry to see the back of Soldier Island, I give you my word.
Oh, so you don't understand.
I don't like the look of him.
I reckon young Marston's suicide must have been a pretty bad shock. Looks years older.
Where is that poor young fellow now?
In the study, put him there myself.
Dr. Armstrong, I suppose it was suicide.
But what else could it be?
I don't know, but suicide.
I had a funny feeling in the night. This Mr. Unknown Owen, what if he's on the island? Rogers may know, or he may have told him to stay so. Pretty nasty thought, though, isn't it?
But would it have been possible for anyone to tamper with Mawson's drink without our knowing about it?
Well, it was just standing up there all night. Some could put a dollop of cyanide in it if they wanted to.
But that...
Oh, there you are, Dr. Armstrong. I've been looking all over the island for you. Could you come up and have a look at my wife?
Yes. Is she feeling under the weather still?
She's...
You won't leave the island without me.
I wish the boat would come. I hate this place.
Yes, I think the sooner we get in contact with the police, the better.
The police?
The police must be notified in the case of a suicide, Miss Claythorne.
Yes, of course.
No sign of breakfast still. I'm sorry, what is going on?
Are you hungry, General? Feeling like breakfast?
Leslie? Leslie, my dear.
Oh, no, I'm not. I'm Vera Claythorne.
Of course. Forgive me. I mistook you for my wife, you see.
Oh.
She's here. On the island, you know.
But I thought your wife was dead long ago.
I thought so, too. But she's here.
Good morning.
Good morning, Captain Lombard.
Seem to have overslept myself. Boat here yet?
No.
A bit late, isn't it?
Yes.
Good morning. You and I could have had a swim before breakfast. Too bad. All this.
Too bad you overslept yourself.
You must have good nerves to sleep like that.
Nothing makes me lose my sleep.
Didn't dream of African natives by any chance?
No. Did you dream of any convicts on Dartmoor?
I don't think that's very funny, Captain Lombard.
You started it, you know. I say, is breakfast ready yet? I'm starving.
The whole domestic staff seems to have gone on strike today.
Well, we can always forage for ourselves.
Hello, that's strange.
What is?
You remember we found one of these little fellows smashed last night?
Yes, that ought to leave nine.
That ought to leave nine. There are only eight.
So there are.
I think that's strange, don't you?
There are probably only nine to begin with. We mistook them for 10 because of the rhyme. Hello, Armstrong. What's the matter?
Miss Rogers is dead.
How?
She died in her sleep. Rogers thought she was still under the influence of the sleeping draught I gave her and came down without disturbing her. He lit the kitchen fire, did this room, and when she still hadn't been downed, he went up and checked on her. Was alarmed by the way she looked and came hunting for me. She's been dead about 5 hours, I'd say.
What was it? Heart?
Impossible to say.
She did have a pretty bad shock last night.
Yes.
She might have been poisoned, I suppose, Doctor?
It is possible.
With the same stuff as young Marston?
No. It would have had to have been some sort of narcotic or hypnotic. One of the barbiturates or chlorals. Something like that.
Say, you did give her some sleeping powders last night, didn't you?
Yes, I gave her a mild dose of luminol.
Didn't give her too much, did you?
Certainly not. What do you mean?
All right, no offense. I just thought that if she had a weak heart,
the amount I gave her could not have hurt anyone.
Then what exactly did happen?
Impossible to say with an autopsy.
If, for instance, this death had occurred in the case of one of your private patients, what would have been your procedure?
Without any knowledge of the woman's previous state of health, I could certainly not give a certificate.
She was a very nervous-looking creature. She had a bad fright last night. Perhaps it was heart failure.
Her heart certainly failed to beat, but what caused it to fail?
Conscience.
I'm sorry, what do you mean by that, Miss Brent?
You all saw her last night, together with her husband, of having deliberately murdered her former employer, an old lady.
And you believe that's true, Miss Brent?
Certainly. You all saw her. She completely broke down and fainted. The thought of having her wickedness brought home to her was too much for her. She literally died of fear.
Well, it is a possible theory, but one cannot adopt it without more exact knowledge of her previous health. If there was a latent cardiac weakness...
Call it, if you prefer, an act of God.
Oh, no, Miss Brent.
You regard it as impossible that a sinner should be struck down by the wrath of God. I do not.
My dear lady, in my experience of ill-doing, Providence usually leaves the work of conviction and chastisement to us mortals. And the process is often fraught with difficulties. There are no shortcuts.
Let's be practical. What did the woman have to eat and drink last night after she went to bed?
Nothing.
Nothing at all? Not a cup of tea or a glass of water? I'll bet you she had a cup of tea. That sort always does.
Rogers assured me she had nothing whatever.
He might say so.
So that's your idea?
Well, why not? You all heard the accusation last night. What if it's true? Miss Brent thinks it is, for one. Rogers and his wife did the old lady in. They're feeling quite safe and happy about it.
Happy?
Well, they know they're in no immediate danger. Then, last night, some lunatic goes and spills the beans. What happens? It's the woman. Cracks, goes to pieces. Did you see him standing around her when she was coming to? Not all husbandly solicitude, but in your sweet life. He was like a cat on hot bricks. And that's the position. They've done a murder and got away with it. If it's all going to be rigged up again now here, it's the wife who will give the show away. She hasn't got the nerve to brazen it out. She's a living danger to her husband. That's what she is. And him? He's all right. He'll go online until the cows come home. But he can't be sure of her. So what does he do? He slips a nice little dollop of something into a nice little cup of tea. And then, after she's had it, he washes up the cup and saucer and tells the doctor she had nothing.
No, that's impossible. A husband wouldn't do that. Not to his wife.
You'd be surprised, Miss Claythorne, what some husbands would do.
Excuse me, miss. I'm just getting started with breakfast. It's lunch that has me worried. I'm not much of a hand as a cook, I'm afraid. Would cold tongue and gelatin be satisfactory? I could manage some fried potatoes, and then there's the tinned cheese and biscuits.
That will be fine, Rogers.
Lunch? Lunch? We shan't be here for lunch. When the hell is that boat coming?
Mr. Bloor!
What?
If you'll pardon me, sir, the boat won't be coming.
What?
Fred Narakot's always here before 8. Is there anything else you need, miss?
No, thank you, Rogers.
And it isn't Rogers. His wife lying dead upstairs. And there he is, cooking breakfast and calmly talking about lunch. Now he says the food won't be coming. How the hell does he know?
Mr. Bloor!
What?
Don't you see? He's dazed. He's just carrying on as a good servant would. It's pathetic, really.
He's playing a fast one. Come on.
The really significant thing is the failure of the boat to arrive.
It's a joke.
It means that we are being deliberately cut off from the land.
That's very little time. Very little time.
What's that, General?
It's very little time. We must have wasted talking about things that don't matter.
Say,
why do you think Narakot hasn't shown up yet?
I think the ubiquitous Mr. Owen has given orders.
He thinks this is all some sort of practical joke, or to be ignored?
You wouldn't fall for that.
Why not? Soldier Island has a reputation for having crazy parties. This is just another crazy idea. Narakot knows there's enough food and drink on this island. He probably thinks it's some practical joke.
Couldn't we light up a bonfire up on top of the island so that they'd see us?
That's probably come to pride of the island. We've been told to ignore all signals. We're cut off already.
Can't we do something?
Yes, we can do something. We can find this homicidal maniac, this funny gentleman who has put us up to this. I'll bet you my life he is somewhere on this island. And the sooner we get him, the better. Because in my opinion, he is as mad as his hatter and as dangerous as a rattlesnake.
Hardly a very good simile, Captain Lombard. A rattlesnake at least gives warning of its approach.
A warning! Yes, my God, a warning! 10 little soldier boys! There were 10 of us when Narakot showed up. 10 little soldier boys went out to dine. One choked his little self, and then there were 9. Choked himself. Mr. Marston, he choked himself. 9 little soldier boys stayed up very late. One overslept himself, and then there were 8. Overslept himself. That last part fits Mrs. Rogers rather well, doesn't it?
You don't think... Do you mean he wants to kill us all?
Yes, Vera. Yes, I do.
And each one fits with the rhyme.
No! No, it's impossible! It's coincidence! It's purely coincidence!
There are only 8 soldier boys here. I suppose you think that's a coincidence, too? What do you think, Lore?
I don't like it.
Then come on. We'll make short work of this. Armstrong, Bloor, we'll search this place.
Well, I'm ready. I suppose nobody's got a revolver or anything like that. It's too much to hope for.
I've got one.
Always carry that about with you?
Usually. I've been in some pretty tight places, you know?
Oh. Well, you've probably never been in a tighter place than you are today. There's a homicidal maniac on this island. He's got a whole arsenal at his disposal. He'll use it.
You may be wrong there, Bloor. Many homicidal maniacs are very quiet, unassuming people.
Delightful fellows.
You'd never know there was anything wrong with them.
Well, if our Mr. Owen turned out to be of that kind, I'll leave him to you, Doctor. Now then, I say, let's make a start. It's just that we do the island well. Captain Lombard does the house.
Right. House ought to be easy. No secret passageways or hidden doors.
Mind he doesn't get you before you get him.
And remember, you two better stick together. One got left behind.
Come on, Armstrong.
A very energetic young man, that Captain Lombard.
Don't you think he's right? If there is somebody else on this island, they'll be bound to find him. It's practically bare rock.
I think this problem needs brains to solve it rather than a drone.
Where are you going?
Stand in the sun and think, my dear.
Where did I put that skein of wool?
Did you leave it upstairs? Would you like me to go and find it?
No, I'll go. I'll know where it's likely to be.
I'm glad Captain Lombard has got that revolver.
They're all wasting time. Wasting time.
What do you mean?
They're all wasting time. It's much better to sit quietly and wait.
Wait for what?
For the end, of course. I wish I could find Leslie.
Your wife?
Yes. I'd wish you'd known her. Of course, I was a lot older than she was. She was only 27. Arthur Richmond was 26. Leslie liked him. They used to talk of music and plays together. I thought she took a motherly interest in the boy. Damn fool, wasn't I? No fool like an old fool. It was exactly like a book the way I found out. You see, I was out in France, and she wrote to the both of us, and she put the letters in the wrong envelopes. So I knew.
Oh, no.
It's quite all right, my dear. It was a very long time ago. But you see, I loved her very much. I believed in her and trusted her. I never told the boy I found out.
What did you do once you found out?
It built up inside of me, my internal rage. It was slow, murderous. I thought he was a damn young hypocrite. I liked the boy. I trusted him even.
I wonder what the others are doing.
I sent the boy to his death.
Oh?
It was quite easy. Mistakes were being made all the time. All anyone could say is that I'd lost my nerve a bit, made a blunder. Sacrificed one of my best men. I never told Leslie I found out. Things went on as usual. But somehow, nothing was quite real anymore. She died of pneumonia. She had a heart-shaped face, and brown eyes, and hair that curled.
Oh, don't.
Yes. I suppose in a way, it was murder. Curious. Murder. I had not thought of it like the time, though. Serves him damn well right. That's what I thought. Well, you understand, don't you?
What do you mean?
Oh, it appears you don't understand. I thought you'd be glad, even, that the end was coming. You're very young. You haven't got that yet. The relief. The sweet relief when you know you've done away with it all, and you haven't got to carry that burden any longer.
I don't know.
Don't talk to me that way. I want to sit here and wait. Wait for Leslie to come to me.
I'm frightened. Oh, I'm frightened.
All correct. No secret passage, one corpse.
Oh, don't!
I say, you do look well. How about a drink to steady your nerves?
A drink? Two corpses in the house at 9 o'clock in the morning, and all you say is, have a drink? An old man going quite crackers. Have a drink. 10 people accused of murder. That's all right, just have a drink. Everything is fine so long as you have a drink.
All right, stay thirsty then.
You're nothing but a waster, an adventurer. You make me tired.
I say, You are head up. What's the matter, my sweet?
I am not your sweet.
I'm sorry. I rather thought you were.
Well, you can think again.
Come now, you don't really feel that way. You and I have something in common. Rogues and murderers can't fall out.
Rogues and murderers?
Fine. You don't like the company of rogues and murderers. You won't have a drink. I'll go and finish searching.
Unpleasant man. Is everything all right?
I'm worried about the general. He really is ill, I think.
Looking out for the boat, General. Looks like his sin has found him out.
Oh, don't.
One must face facts.
Can any of us afford to throw stones?
Even if his wife was no better than she was, and she must have been a pretty depraved woman, he had no right to take judgment into his own hands.
What about Beatrice Taylor?
Who?
That was the name, wasn't it?
You're referring about that absurd accusation about myself.
Yes.
Now that we're alone, I have no objection to telling you the facts of the case. Indeed, I would like for you to hear them. It was not a fit subject to discuss before young gentlemen, so naturally, I refused to say anything about it last night. That girl, Beatrice Taylor, she was in my service. I was very much deceived in her. She had nice manners and was clean and willing. I was very much pleased with her. Of course, all that was the sheerest hypocrisy. She was a loose girl with no morals. Disgusting. It was not too long after that I found out that they were what she called in trouble. It was of great shock to me. Her parents were decent folks who brought her up strictly. I'm glad to say they did not condone her behavior.
What happened?
Naturally, I refused to keep her an hour under my roof. No one shall ever say I condoned immorality.
Did she drown herself?
Yes.
How old was she?
17.
Only 17?
Quite old enough to know how to behave. I told her what a low and depraved thing she was. I told her that she was beyond the pale and that no decent person would bring her under their roof. I told her that her child would be the child of sin and would be branded all of his life and that the man would not ever dream of marrying her. I told her how I ever felt sore of ever bringing her under my roof.
You told a girl of 17 all that?
Yes, I'm glad to say I broke her down utterly.
Poor little devil.
I have no patience towards the indulgence towards sin.
And then I assume you forced her out of the house?
Of course.
And she didn't dare go home. What did you feel like when you found out she drowned herself?
Feel like?
Yes. Didn't you blame yourself?
Of course not. I had nothing with which to reproach myself.
I believe you really feel that way. That makes it even more horrible.
That girl is unbalanced. The heathen are sunk down in the pit that they are made, and the net with which they hid is their own foot taken. The Lord is known by the judgment he executeth. The wicked is snared in the work of his own hand.
Breakfast is ready.
Be quiet. The wicked shall be turned into hell.
Do you know where the gentlemen are, Miss? Breakfast is ready.
Sir Lawrence Wargrave is standing outside. Mr. Bloor and Dr. Armstrong are searching the island. I shan't bother about them.
Shall not the isles shake at the sound of the fall, when the wounded cry, when the slaughter is made in the midst of thee?
Shall we go in?
I don't feel like eating.
Breakfast is ready.
Then all the princes of the sea shall come down from their thrones, and lay away their robes, and put off their broidered garments. They shall clothe themselves with trembling, and shall sit upon the ground, and shall tremble at every moment, and be astonished at thee.
Reading aloud, Miss Brent.
It is my custom to read a portion of the Bible every day.
Very good habit, I'm sure.
What luck did you have?
There's no cover on the island, no caves. No one could hide anywhere.
That's right. What about the house, Lombard?
There's no one here for us. I'll put my life on it. I've been over it from the attic to the cellar.
And breakfast is getting cold.
Breakfast? Come on, Blore, you've been yelping for breakfast ever since you got up. Let's eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow we die. Or who knows? Perhaps even today.
You want to be ashamed of such levity, Captain Lombard?
Come on, General! Can't have this, I say, sir.
Good God. One got left behind. There's a knife in Mackenzie's back.
Thank you.
My God, he's dead.
But he can't be.
There's only us on the island. We just checked.
Exactly. Don't you realize that this clever and cunning criminal is always comfortably one step ahead of us? That he knows exactly what we are going to do and plans accordingly. There's only one place, you know, where a successful murderer can hide and get away with it.
One place? Where?
Here. In this room. Mr. Owen is one of us. Mr. Board?
I want to get you alone. You were right what you said this morning. This damn murderer is one of us. I think I know which one.
Really?
Ever hear of the Lizzie Borden case in America? An old couple killed with an axe in the middle of the morning. The only person who could have done it was their daughter, a respectable middle-aged spinster. Incredible. So incredible, the jury acquitted her, but the police never found any other explanation.
So your solution to the problem is Miss Emily Brent?
That woman is crazy, I tell you. As mad as a hatter. Religious mad, I tell you. She is the one, and we must watch her.
I'd rather inform that your suspicions were in a different quarter.
Yes. But I've changed my mind, and I'll tell you why. She's not scared. She's the only one who isn't. Why? Because she knows damn well she's in no real danger.
We've made some coffee. It's cold in here.
I'd hardly believe it when you think of such a beautiful day it was in the morning.
Miss Brent's.
I'll take it.
You were right to insist on our going to breakfast and having some whiskey with it. I do feel better.
Court always adjourns for lunch.
All the same, it feels too horrible to be true. But what are we going to do about it?
We must hold an informal court of inquiry. We might at least be able to eliminate a few innocent people.
You haven't got a hunch of any kind, have you, Miss Claythorne?
Well, if Miss Claythorne suspects one of us three, that is a rather awkward question, Mr. Ward.
I'm sure it isn't any of you three. If you ask me who I suspected, I'd say Dr. Armstrong.
Armstrong?
Yes, because don't you see? He's had far and away the best opportunity to kill Mrs. Rogers. Terribly easy for him as a doctor to give her an overdose of the sleeping stuff.
Yes, but someone else gave her the brandy, remember?
Her husband had a good opportunity to administer a drug.
Oh, it isn't Rogers. He doesn't have the brains to fix all this stunt. Nor the money. Besides, you can see he's scared stiff.
Beatrice Taylor?
There's no hope of rescue until this guy's down. Is that coffee? See, I'm taking coffee now.
Such restraint in the face of danger is nothing short of heroic.
I do not profess to be weather prophet, but I should say that chance of a boat arriving here, even if it knew of our plight, in under 24 hours is unlikely. Even if the storm dies down, the sea has still to go down.
You're awfully wet.
Is anyone a swimmer? Would it be possible to swim to the mainland?
It's over a mile. And in this sea, you'd be dashed on the rocks and drowned.
Drowned. Drowned in the pond.
I beg your pardon, Miss Brent.
After dinner nap.
It's terribly cold in here.
I could light a fire if you like this.
That sounds good. Thank you, Rogers.
Very sound scheme, Rogers.
Has anybody seen the top bathroom curtain?
Really, Rogers? Are you going bats, too?
The bathroom curtain?
Yes, sir. It's scarlet oil.
Anybody seen a scarlet oil silk curtain? No good, I'm afraid, Rogers.
Never mind. I just thought it was odd.
Everything on this island is odd.
I'll get some sticks and a few knobs of coal and get a nice pipe going.
I wonder if he'd like some hot coffee. He's awfully wet. Rogers!
What's become of Armstrong?
He's gone to his room to rest.
Somebody's probably batted him in by now.
I expect he had the sense to bolt his door.
You know, it won't be so easy now. We're all on our guard.
We mustn't be too optimistic. I would like shortly to recommend a few measures that we should all adopt in defense.
Against whom?
Against each other. Of the 10 people who arrived here, 3 are definitely cleared. That leaves 10 of us, 10 little soldier boys.
One of whom is a bogus little soldier boy.
Exactly.
Well, in spite of what Miss Cleethorn just said, I say that you, Sir Lawrence, and Dr. Armstrong are just above suspicion. He's a well-known doctor, and you're known all over England.
That is hardly a good conclusion, Mr. Poole. Judges have gone mad before, so have doctors. So have policemen.
Hear, hear. Well, does he want any coffee?
He'd rather make himself a nice cup of tea. Do you think we ought to bring up Dr. Armstrong a cup?
I'll take it if you like.
I'll go. I want to have a change.
Yes, you ought to. You'll catch cold.
I think Dr. Armstrong might prefer to see me. He might not admit you, Captain Lombard. He might be afraid of your revolver.
The revolver. I'd like a quick word with you about that.
Do go and change.
What were you going to say? I'd just like to know why you brought a revolver down here on what's supposed to be your little social visit.
You do, don't you? Well, I've been in a tight place once or twice. I've gotten to the habit of carrying a revolver around. It's a nice feeling knowing you have a gun in. Wouldn't you agree?
Don't carry them. I want the truth about this weapon.
What a damn suspicious fellow you are.
I know a fishy story when I hear one.
If it's about that revolver, I'd like to hear about that too.
Well, I got a letter on behalf of Mr. and Mrs. Owen, asking me to come here as a guest. The writer heard I was a good man in a difficult spot. He said there'd be some danger, but I'd be okay if I kept my eyes open.
I'd never have fallen for that.
Well, I did. God, I was bored in this tame country. It was an intriguing proposition, you must admit.
Too vague for my liking.
That's what's the whole charm. It spurred my curiosity.
Curiosity killed the cat.
Yes. Quite.
Oh, do go and change.
I'm going. The maternal instinct, I think it's called.
Don't be ridiculous.
That's a tall story. If it's true, why didn't you just tell us last night?
He probably thought this was the very emergency for which he had been prepared.
Perhaps it is.
Hardly likely. It was just Mr. Owen's little bit of cheese to get him into the trap of the rest of us. He must have known him well enough to rely on his curiosity.
Oh, if he's telling the truth, he's a wrong in that man. I wouldn't trust him a yard.
True.
We must get out of here. We must, before it's too late.
One thing we must not do is give way to nerves.
Yes, I'm sorry. Rather a case of physician heal thyself, but I've been overworked lately and run down.
Sleeping badly?
Yes. I've been dreaming. Hospital, operations, a knife to my throat.
Real nightmares.
Yes. Do you ever dream that you're sentencing a man in court?
Are you by any chance referring to a man by the name of Edward Seaton? I should assure you I lose no sleep over the death of Edward Seaton, a particularly cruel and cold-blooded murderer. The jury liked him. They were inclined to let him off, but I could see, however. I cooked Seaton's goose.
Cold in here, isn't it? Yes, where is Rogers? He's been a long time.
He said he's got to get some sticks.
Sticks? Sticks! My God, sticks!
My God, is another one gone? Are there only sticks?
There are only 5.
Five.
Rogers and Lombard.
No, not Philip.
Rogers.
Where the hell is Lombard? Like a madman.
Philip, I...
Have you seen Rogers?
No, should I?
2 more soldiers have gone. 2?
Philip, I thought it was you.
Well, what is it, man?
In the scullery. In the scullery.
Scullery?
Yes.
How?
Snacks. Somebody must have got him whilst he was bent over the wood box.
So. One shot of something, and then there were 6.
Fair, stop it.
She'll be okay. Are there any bees on this island? That's next. Six little stupid boys playing with a hive. A bumblebee stung one, and then there were five. A bumblebee stung one. We all look pretty spry. Nothing wrong with any of us. Unless... a hypodermic syringe.
Modern bee sting.
While she was sitting there, one of us.
One of us.
Which of us?
Sitting in a row, watching each other, waiting for the blow. New version, up to date.
I hardly think this is a moment for facetiousness.
Had to relieve the gloom. Damn, that electric plant is running down. How about we play a game? We can create a new one. Suspicions. We can have A suspects, B, B suspects, C, and so on. Why don't we start with you, Blore? It's no surprise who you fancy. It sticks out by a mile. You think it's me, don't you?
I wouldn't say no to that.
You're quite wrong, you know. If I was to create abstract murder, there'd have to be something in it for me.
Well, you told two different stories. You acted suspiciously from the start. First you say that you came here with a revolver. Now you say you've lost it.
I have lost it.
That's a likely story.
What do you think I've done with it? I suggested myself that you search me.
Oh, you haven't got it on you. You're too clever for that. But you know where it is.
You think I've hidden it away for later?
Shouldn't be surprised.
Why don't you use your brains, Blore? If I had wanted to, I could have shot the lot of you by now. Pop, 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 pop.
Yes, but that's not the big idea.
The crazy touch? My God, man, I'm sane enough.
The doctor here says there are some lunatics you'd never know were lunatics. That's true enough, I'd say.
We can't just sit here doing nothing. Surely there's something that we can do. If we lit a bonfire.
It is, I'm afraid, a matter of time and patience. The weather will clear. Then we can light a bonfire heliograph signal.
A matter of time? Time we don't have! Time, we should all be dead!
Precautions we have adopted, I think, will be adequate.
I tell you, we shall all be dead. All but one. He'll think of something. He's thinking now.
What was her name again? Cleese? Was it nerves that made you do her in, Doctor?
No. Drink. My God, I was a heavy drinker. I was drunk when I operated on her. I can remember her now. My hands shaking all over the place. Quite a simple operation. I can remember her now. A heavy, countrified woman. And I killed her.
So I was right. That's how it was.
Sister knew, of course. But she was loyal to me. Or to the hospital. I gave up drink. I gave it up altogether. Went in for a study of nervous diseases.
Very successful.
Oh, one or two lucky shots, one or two important women. They talk to their friends, and I've been so busy I've hardly known which way to turn. I've got to the top of the tree.
Until Mr. Unknown Owen. And down will come Cradle and Doctor and all.
Oh, will you stop with your damnable sneering?
Gentlemen, please. Cannot forge a quarrel.
That's okay by me. I apologize.
The precautions we have adopted, I believe, will be adequate.
So long as we remain inside of each other, a repetition of the tragedies that have occurred is... must be impossible. We have all subjected to a search, therefore we know that no man is armed with either a gun nor a knife, nor does any man have any drug about his person. As long as we remain inside of each other, we will be fine.
But we shall need food! Sleep!
That's what I say.
As long as we aren't detached from each other, we will be safe.
Safe?
You're silent there.
There isn't anything to say. I wonder what the time is. It's this awful waiting. Watching and waiting for the hours to pass, and yet feeling that they may be the last. What is the time?
8:30.
Is that all?
It's that awful light. How are the candles holding up?
We have a full packet. The storm's dying down a bit. What do you think, sir?
You mustn't be too optimistic.
If you like, I could go downstairs and open some tongue and bring up some coffee. Would that be all right?
Not quite, Miss Claythorne. It may be inadvisable to eat something you prepared out of our sight.
Oh. You don't like me, do you?
It is not a matter of likes or dislikes.
There are very few tricks I will get past you, Sir Lawrence. If you aren't offended at me saying so, you're my fancy.
This is hardly the time to take the luxury of taking offense, Captain Lombard.
I don't think it's Bloor. I think he lacks the imagination for this type of job. All I can say is, Bloor, if you are the criminal, I take my hat off to you for being a damn fine actor.
Thank you.
For nothing. I don't think it's a doctor. I think you lack the nerve. Vera, you on the other hand, you have the nerve, but you strike me as eminently sane. Therefore, you'd only commit murder if you had a thoroughly good motive.
Thank you.
I've just thought of something.
Splendid. Animal, mineral, or vegetable?
This man says he's a police officer. But we've no proof of that. He only said so after the gramophone record when his name had been given. Before that, he was pretending to be a South African millionaire. What if this police officer is another impersonation of his? What do we know? Nothing at all.
Oh, he's a police officer, all right. Look at his feet.
That's enough for you, Mr. Lombard.
Well, now we know where we are. By the way, Miss Claythorne suspects you, Doctor. Oh, yes, she does. Haven't you seen her shoot you a dirty look from time to time? It actually all works out quite perfectly. I suspect Sir Lawrence. Bloor suspects me. Armstrong suspects Bloor. What do you think, Sir Lawrence?
Earlier this morning, I had come to a certain conclusion. I believed that all the events that had occurred pointed quite unmistakably to one person. I am still of that same opinion.
Which one?
No, I think it would be inadvisable to say that person's name at the present moment.
Inadvisable in the public interest?
Exactly.
What about the food idea?
I can't say that I'm hungry.
I'm not ravenous myself.
Let's stay here. It's safe here.
You can have a guzzle by yourself, Bloor.
Tell you what, suppose I go in and bring a tin of biscuits.
Good idea. Bloor?
Yeah.
An open tin. It's that damn wind rattling those curtains.
I wonder what happened to that scarlet oil silk curtain. The one that Rogers missed?
From the wildest stretch of my imagination, I cannot see what a homicidal maniac wants with a scarlet oil silk curtain.
Things seem to have been disappearing. Miss Brent lost that skein of knitting wool.
So, whoever the murderer is, he or she, is also a kleptomaniac.
How does it go? 5 little soldier boys.
Going in for law, 1 got in chancery.
In chancery, but how could that apply? And yes.
Precisely, my dear.
But I'm
that is why I'm sitting right here.
I'm casting you for role of murderer, not victim.
Term can't apply to a boxer.
We can start a free fight, my dear. That'll let you out.
That awful, awful rhyme. It keeps going round and round in my head. I think I shall remember it till I die. Mr. Bloor's a long time.
Expect the big bad wolf has got him by now.
I asked you once before to try and restrain your rather peculiar sense of humor, Captain Lombard.
Sorry, sir. It must be a form of nervousness.
Put your hands up. Surgeon.
No, thank you.
Come now, you've had no dinner.
I couldn't eat anything.
I warn you, Bloor will wolf the lot.
I don't see why you'd be so funny about it. Starving ourselves won't do us any good. I say, how are we for cigarettes?
I'm out.
I've run out too.
Fortunately, I'm a pipe smoker.
I've got a whole pack of cigarettes upstairs in my room. I'll go fetch them. I could do with a cigarette myself. See that you all stay where you are.
Ooh, not bad, these biscuits.
What are they? Cheese?
Cheese and celery.
A girl ought to have had some.
Her nerves are in a bad state.
I don't think I'd agree with you there, Doctor. Miss Claythorne strikes me as a cool, resourceful young lady. Quite remarkably so.
So that's your idea? That she's the guilty party?
Hardly likely. A woman.
You and I, Doctor, see women from slightly different angles.
I say, what about a spot of whiskey? Thirsty.
Good idea. Provided we tackle an unopened bottle.
William!
Miss Claythorne! Miss Claythorne! Vera! Miss Claythorne, where are you? I can't see anything!
Philip, where are you?
Vera! Vera!
Philip! Philip, where are you? I've lost you.
Here I am.
It's awful in the dark. Why can't we have some light?
Here, I've got a lighter.
Where is Dr. Armstrong?
I'm hunting for the matches.
Never get, forget the matches. Get more candles.
Philip, it went right around my throat.
What did?
The window was open in my room and it blew out the candle when I walked in the door. And then a long strand of seaweed wrapped around my throat. I felt in the dark that I was being strangled by a wet hand.
I don't wonder that you yelled.
Who hung the seaweed there?
I don't know. But when I find out who did, he'll be sorry he was ever born.
Who's that?
Oh, it's only me, Miss Claythorne.
Here we are. Who fired that shot?
Oh!
He's dead. Shot through the head.
One got in chancery.
Miss Claythorne.
Vera.
You got me to leave. You all got me to go upstairs for cigarettes. You stole Rogers' curtain and Miss Brent's skein of wool. You did all of this so that you could kill that helpless old man in the dark. You're mad. Crazy, all of you! God, let me get out of here.
Three little soldier boys, wondering as they go, wondering which who's the next to go.
Oh, Philip.
Well, that's all right, Miss Claythorne. I don't mind joking on a full stomach.
I must say I was hungry, but all the same, I don't think I shall ever fancy tin tongue again.
I was wanting that meal. I feel like a new man.
We've been here nearly 24 hours without food. That does lower the morale.
Somehow, in the daylight, everything seems different.
You mustn't forget,
There's still a dangerous homicidal maniac somewhere loose on this island.
Why is it one doesn't feel jittery about it anymore?
Because we know now, without any possible doubt, who it is.
That's right.
I said all along it was Dr. Armstrong.
Yes, you did. Yes, you did, my dear. Until you went completely bats and suspected all of us.
It does seem rather silly in the daylight.
Very silly.
Well, it is Armstrong. What's happened to him?
We know. What he wants us to think has happened to him.
What exactly did you find?
One shoe. Just one shoe. Sitting prettily on the edge of a cliff. Inference. Dr. Armstrong has gone completely off his onion and committed suicide.
All very circumstantial, even to one little China soldier broken over there in the doorway.
It seems like that's rather overdoing it. A man wouldn't do all that if he was just going to commit suicide.
But we're fairly certain he didn't commit suicide. He only had to make it appear that way. Like he was a seventh victim, all according to plan.
I suppose he really is dead.
I'm a bit suspicious of death without bodies.
How odd it is to think that there are five dead bodies sitting in there, and we've been eating tin tongue.
The delightful feminine disregard for the facts. There are six dead bodies, and they are not all in there.
Oh, no, she's right. There are only five.
Did you count Mrs. Rogers?
Yes, I did. She's the fifth.
Marston is one, Mrs. Rogers is two, Wargrave is three, Rogers is four, Mackenzie is five, Mrs. Brent is six.
Seven, eight, nine. Armstrong 10. You're right, old man. Sorry.
Don't you think it'd be an idea if we took Mrs. Rogers down to the morgue, too?
I'm a detective, not an undertaker.
Oh, stop talking about bodies. Point is, Dr. Armstrong murdered them.
Well, would you like to know what happened the night after, you know, threw your fit in? Suspect us all of murder.
Do tell me, what happened last night?
Well, after you had your episode and locked yourself in your room, we all decided it would be better to, you know, go to bed. So we did, and locked ourselves in our rooms.
About an hour later, I heard someone walk through the hallway. I went out, I checked on Bloor's door. He was there, all right. That's when I went to Armstrong's room. It was empty. That's when I tapped on your door and told you to sit tight, no matter what happens. Then I came down here. And the window on the balcony was open, and the revolver was on the table, lying prettily next to it.
But why the devil should Armstrong just chuck that revolver away?
No idea. Either he's crazy, or it's an accident.
Well, where do you suppose he is?
Hiding? Waiting? To have a go at one of us?
We ought to search the house.
What, and walk into an ambush?
Oh, I never thought of that.
Are you sure you heard no one moving around last night?
I imagined all sorts of things, but nothing short of setting the house on fire would have gotten me to unlock my door.
I see. Just thoroughly suspicious.
What's the use of talking? What are we gonna do?
In my opinion, do nothing. Sit here and take no chances.
Look here, I want to go after that man.
What a dog of the bulldog breed you are, Bloor. Between friends and without prejudice, you did go in for that bit of perjury, didn't you?
Well, suppose it doesn't make any odds now. Lander was innocent, all right. The gang squared me, and between us, we put him away for a stretch. Mind you, I wouldn't admit it now if it wasn't that.
You think we're all in the same boat.
Well, could I admit it in front of Mr. Justice Wargrave?
No, hardly.
I say, that fellow Seaton. Do you think he was innocent?
I'm sure of it. Wargrave had a reason for wanting him out of the way. Well, Bloor, I'm just happy you came off of your virtuous perch. I hope you made a tidy bit of it.
It's the least of what I should have done. They're a mean lot, that Benny gang. Got my promotion, though.
And Lander got his penal servitude and died in jail.
I couldn't tell he was going to die, could I?
No, that was just your bad luck.
His, you mean?
Yours, too. Because of that, you might find your life getting cut short unpleasantly soon.
What, me? By Armstrong? Yeah, I'll watch it.
You're gonna have to. Remember, there are only three soldier boys out there.
Well, what about you?
I'll be quite all right. I've been in difficult places before, and I've gotten out of them. Besides, I still got my revolver handy.
Yes, the revolver. Now, listen here. You said you found that revolver lying down over there? What's to say you haven't had it the entire time?
You want the same old gramophone record.
No room in your head for new ideas. No, but it's a good idea,
and you're sticking to it.
And I would come up with a better tale if I were you.
I only wanted something simple, that a policeman could understand.
What's wrong with the police?
Nothing. Now that you've felt the force.
Now look here, Captain Lombard. You're an honest man, as you pretend.
Neither one of us are honest men.
You are telling the truth for once. You watch the square thing and chuck that revolver down there.
Don't be an ass.
I've said I will go through the house looking for Armstrong, haven't I? If I do that, will you lend me the revolver?
No, I won't. That revolver is mine, and I'm sticking to it.
Then, do you know what I'm beginning to think?
You're not beginning to think it at all, you square-headed flatty. You thought it last night, and you've gone back to your original idea. That I'm the one and only Mr. Unknown Owen. Is that it?
I won't contradict you. Well, then I warn
you. I think you both are behaving like a pair of children.
Sorry, teacher.
Of course, Captain Lombard isn't the Unknown Owen. The Unknown Owen is Armstrong, and I'll tell you one very good proof of it.
What?
Think of the rhyme. Four little soldier boys going out to sea. A red herring swallowed one, and then there were three. Don't you see the subtlety of it? A red herring? That's Armstrong's pretended suicide. So he isn't really dead.
It's very ingenious.
To my mind, it's absolute proof. You see, it's all mad because he's mad. He takes a strange, childish, crazy pleasure in sticking to the rhyme and making everything happen in that way. Dressing up the judge, killing Rogers while he was chopping sticks, using a hypodermic needle on Miss Brent when he may as well just have drugged her. He's got to make it all fit in.
That might give us our next clue. Where do we go from here? Three little soldier boys walking in the zoo. A big bear hugged one, and then there were two. Well, he's gonna have a job with that one. There's not a zoo on the island. I say, Captain Lombard, what about a nice bottle of beer?
Do stop thinking about your stomach, Bloor. It will be your undoing.
Yes, probably. But there's plenty of beer in the kitchen.
Yes, and if somebody wanted to offer you, the first place they think of putting it would be in a nice bottle of beer.
And what's that? A boat! A boat!
Bloor got his.
Is he?
Yes.
How?
Head stove in. Booby trap. A wire set along the ground. Drop the bronze bear statue on him.
Bear? How ghastly! It's this awful childishness.
I know. God, what a fool Bloor was!
Let's get away from here, Philip, please.
All right. We'll go to the cliff. It's a sheer drop on the other side, and we'll be able to see if anybody approaches from the house.
Anything is better than here.
Won't you be rather cold in that dress?
I'd be colder if I were dead.
Perhaps you're right. A quick reconnaissance first.
Be careful, Philip. Please.
Don't worry. I'm no Bloor. There's no window directly above me. Hello? There's something down there, washed up in the rocks.
What? It looks like a body.
You stay here. I'm gonna go have a look.
Armstrong. Armstrong's body.
It's Armstrong. His body washed up at high water mark.
And then there were two.
Yes, Vera. And now we know where we are.
Now we know where we are?
Poor Grave always knew you were a clever one.
You.
So you did drown that kid after all.
I didn't. That's where you're wrong. Please believe me. Please listen to me.
I am listening, and you better make this a damn good story.
It isn't a story.
It's the truth. It wasn't me, it was someone else.
Who?
Man. Peter's uncle. I was in love with him.
Well-known tale of a wicked uncle.
Yes, he was wicked. And I didn't know. If Peter had been a girl, Hugh would have got everything. There was always this rock that Peter was wanting to swim out to. Of course, I never let him. It was too dangerous. One day, I had to go back to the house to get something I'd forgotten. And when I came back, I saw Peter swimming out to the rock. I rushed down and tried to stop him, but Hugh tried to stop me. He held on to me. He said, "Don't be a fool." I told the little ass he could do it.
And everything went off well at the inquest.
Do you think anybody would have believed me? Besides, I really did love him.
You certainly are an accomplished liar, Vera.
Can't you believe the truth when you hear it? Who set the trap that killed Bloor?
I did it, and Armstrong's dead. I've broken some of the commandments in my time, but there is one thing that I won't stand for, and that's murder.
You won't stand for murder? What about those natives you left to die in Africa?
That's what's so damn funny. I did it. For once, just once, Mark II, I played the role of the hero. I risked my life, I left my guns and my ammunition for my men. And I took my chance in the brush. By the most miraculous of luck, I came off. But not in time to save the lives of my men. Word got around that I deliberately left them. That's life for you.
Do you really expect me to believe a stupid lie like that?
I got a kick out of watching their faces.
You can't expect me to be fooled by something like that.
Blast you!
Why didn't I see it in your face before? It's there in your face, the face of a killer.
No, you can't fool me any longer.
Now!
Vera.
If you take one step closer, I'll shoot.
You're cunning. Clever.
It's all come true. My 10 little soldiers plan, my rhyme,
Silence in the court!
If there is any more noise, we shall have the court cleared. It's all right, my dear, it's all right. Don't be frightened. This is a court of justice. You'll get justice here. You thought I was a ghost. You thought I was dead. Armstrong said I was dead. That was the clever part of my plan. We said we'd trap the murderer, said we'd fix my supposed death so I should be free to spy upon the guilty one. He thought it most ingenious. Met me by the cliff late that night without any suspicion. I pushed him over. So easily. He swallowed my red herring, all right. You know, Vera Claythorne, all my life, I've wanted to take life. Yes, to take life. I've had to get what enjoyment I could out of sentencing the guilty to death. I've always enjoyed that. But I wanted more. I wanted to do it myself, my own hands. But I'm a judge of the High Court. I've got a sense of justice, as between our sovereign lord, the king, and the prisoner at the bar will true deliverance make. Guilty, my lord. Yes, guilty. You are all guilty, you know. But the law couldn't touch you, so I had to take the law into my own hands.
requirement! Silence in the court! Anthony Marston first, then Mrs. Rogers, Barbiton and the brandy. Mackenzie, stabbed. Got Rogers when he was bent over chopping sticks. Doped Emily Brent's coffee so she couldn't feel the hypodermic. Booby trap for Boar. Boar was a fool. I always knew it'd be easy to get Boar. Turning that revolver was a clever touch. Made the end interesting. I always knew you two would suspect each other. The question was, who'd win out? I banked on you, my dear. Female of the species. Besides, it's always more exciting to have a girl at the end. Vera Elizabeth Claythorne, I sentence you to death.
Stop! Stop, I'm not guilty, I'm not guilty!
Oh, they all must say that. Must be not guilty. Unless, of course, you're going all out for a verdict of insanity, but you're not mad. I'm mad. But you're not.
You'll never get away with this.
I shan't be around to find out, my dear. I shall be found laid neatly on my bed, shot through the forehead, in accordance with the record kept by my fellow victims. Most ingenious was keeping your fingerprints on the trigger of the revolver. You see, set a contraption. Using the cord for my spectacles, I will attach the cord to the trigger, then attach the revolver to the door. When I put the weight of my body in the glasses, it'll pull the trigger, attaching the gun from the door and jarring the door open. Needless to say, in the morning there will come from the land boats and men, and they will find 10 dead bodies and an unsolved problem on Soldier Island. But first things first.
But I'm innocent. I swear I'm telling the truth. You are judged. You can tell the difference between when someone is I'm innocent.
You know, my dear, you were one of the last of my guests to be recruited. I happened to be crossing the Atlantic at the time and found myself the sole occupant of a smoking room with a young, handsome gentleman. He had taken a considerable amount of drink and was in a confidential maudlin state. And he told me the most intriguing story. I can remember his words now. I've known a murderess. Known her, I tell you. And what's more was, I was crazy about her. You wouldn't think a girl like that, a nice, straight, jolly girl, would take a kid out to sea and let it drown.
No, please.
Well, naturally, I have to be absolutely certain, so I asked him if he was sure, and suddenly sober, he thrust his face into mine. Quite sure. You see, she did it all for me. I knew the moment I looked at her.
I never killed that child. I never wanted to kill him.
You know, during the gramophone recital, I watched all of your faces very closely. And after my long court experience, I had no doubt in my mind that you were guilty, my dear. And now, you've killed Lombard. How does it feel to be a killer? To be guilty? Oh, you liked him, didn't you, my dear? Prisoner at the bar, have you any reason why sentence should not be passed on you?
can't spoil my lovely rhyme. My 10 little soldier boys, you're the last one. One little soldier boy left all alone. He went and hanged himself. I must have my hanging, and you must pay for your crimes, my dear. For that poor, innocent child that you murdered. For Lombard. Yes. One little soldier boy left all alone. Goodbye, my dear. He went and hanged himself. And then there were... Now I'm forgetting something. Of course, how silly of me! We can't make it look like you killed yourself now, could we, my dear?
Another one bites the dust, hey, hey! Another one bites the dust, hey!